Forest Lake product and the Ogden product. And we certainly welcome them as our guest speaker this morning. If you look at the bulletin, those of you who don't know, he has taken on full-time ministry with the Good News Yale Ministry. And I don't know exactly how much Chaplain Leonard's doing, but I think Chaplain Leonard's trying to retire and leave it to Josiah. But anyway, he's in full-time ministry up at the Okaloosa County Jail. So we welcome our brother, Josiah Aldridge.
Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son, or your daughter, your male servant, or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that's in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that's your neighbor's. Now our reading from the epistles is from 1 Corinthians, first chapter, 18 through 31. 18 through 31.
Jail chaplain, and I grew up here at Forest Lake.
Now, we're at another church, and I'm in the jail all the time, and one of the things that I've learned and grown with is an appreciation, not that we have to, we don't all have to worship alike, thanks be to God, but an appreciation for things like the church calendar. Okay, so here's a brief apology. Why would a guy who's tasked with ministering to people who probably it's been a while since they darkened the door of the church, why would he just sit there and read a bunch of the Bible to them? And why would he bounce around like the church calendar so often does? Right now we're in the Lenten season. And one of the great things about the Lenten season and as all the church calendar, it reminds us that time is God's. Time is God's. Okay? In jail, if you've never been in jail, I encourage you, we have regular briefings for folks over who are over 18 and don't have criminal records of their own. You can come and we can show you the ins and outs of jail and jail ministry. We do those once a quarter. We just had one this last week. It was great. I'm trying to learn from Chaplain Lennon how to suck people into the jail just like he suckered me in so many years ago. So there's my plug. If you're looking for a place to minister, we definitely have open doors in the jail. Jail, you are always, the very air you breathe is just saturated with time. You're either just sitting there, when am I going to get sentenced? What's going to happen? Am I going to go free or am I going to go down the road to prison for 15 years? Time is everywhere, but it's a disjointed sort of time. It's a time that focuses on me. This is what's going to be next for me. What's going to be next for my life? And that's what suffering does to us. You're no stranger to that. You don't have to go to jail to get stuck in the isolation of suffering. But rather, what does the Bible teach us? The Bible teaches us, like the great words of Psalm 22, to look outside of ourselves, to remember in the middle of our suffering to say, wait, what's God done for all of his people through all the ages? What's God done for me? All right, now I've got some perspective to deal with my suffering. So, that's my brief apology for that. Why read all of it at once? Well, because I could sit here and I could talk to you all day. I like to talk. I don't know if you can tell that. But my words are not nearly as important as the very words of God. That's what I just got done reading. We got to hear the words of God. Now, thanks be to God, me and the kids just watched a kids movie on the Reformation last night. And it's such a wonderful gift we have to read the Bible and to be able to hear the Bible in our own language, right? But there's a temptation that comes with that. There's a temptation for me to take my Bible and just go over my own little cubbyhole and just start reading the Bible and never interacting with anybody else on it, never hearing the words of God proclaimed. There's something special that happens when we gather together and we hear the word of God from somebody else. It's a little bit tougher to skate around the conviction when we hear God's word proclaimed. So, I'm just going to walk through briefly. There's no way that I can exhaustively exposit all of those passages of Scripture, so I'm not going to try. We're just going to look at some of the highlights and hopefully see how these things get together. One of the things that I love to do is to show how God's Word fits together and to show how often God's Word things that we don't understand. You know, I grew up in this church, which was faithful, to continually teach the Word of God. But even though I was taught the Word of God often, a lot of times I missed connections. I didn't realize how things connected to one another. I didn't realize what Jesus was doing so much of the time. So one of the things we'll hopefully do is see, how did Jesus do it with the whole cleansing the temple thing? Why did he make a whip and start beating people out? What was the deal there? So that's the goal. We're just going to briefly touch on these and see the connection. We're going to start with Psalm 19. All right, now that I've talked, let's hear God's word talk. Psalm 19, some have called the three books that God opens to us. I'm actually totally stealing some other guy's sermon title, but it's very apt. The three books that God opens to us. We see three things here. The first book that God opens to us is the book of what old-timey theologians like to call general or natural revelation. Okay, that's just a big fancy word for looking at the world around us and realizing, as this psalm tells us, it's talking about God. Even though you might sit out there and you might hear nothing but the wind blowing and the birds chirping, remember what Jesus said? Jesus said, if you guys shut up, if you guys don't talk about me, the stones themselves are going to cry out. You ever listen to a stone? Hear what it says? You should talk to my dad over there. That guy can help tell you what stones say and what birds say, because he teaches science at a Christian school. And he has given me a great love for looking at creation and saying, oh, wow, that's really cool. That's not just an interesting fact. That's something that God himself designed. We'll see how the cross is weirder than the platypus here shortly. So, creation speaks about God. Creation declares God's glory. Romans 1 tells us this. Romans 1 says, hey, there's nowhere and nobody who has not heard from the world around them that there's a God, which means that God is not me, and therefore there's someone responsible to, someone who has made the world, someone who's made the way the world's supposed to work, and I should probably try to figure out who that is and how he wants me to live. But God didn't just leave us with the world, right? God didn't leave us with the world declaring his glory. God gave us his word. Hebrews tells us in times past, God's spoken various times, various places, through his prophets, but now in these last days, he's spoken to us through his son. Psalm 19, like Psalm 119, it's like a mini Psalm 119. It loves the word of God, loves the law of God, extols the glory of the word of God. What's it do? It revives the soul. It makes wise simple people. Isn't that cool? If you go to school, in school, you know, our culture loves to try to put everything in neat little boxes. In school, you've got the really smart kids, right? You've got the really smart kids over there, and they are on the fast track, right? They're like, people are trying to shove them through classes fast. And then you've got the kids over there, they used to call it the short bus, right? They're not as fast as your average Joe. They really struggle. Sometimes they can kind of put off over there. And then you got the middle track, which is just full of regular Joes. And a lot of times, conventional wisdom, you know, those folks over there, they're in the special bus. They're just gonna be special forever. Us here in the middle, we can look at the folks over there and kind of look down on them maybe, and bow to the wisdom of the folks over here. But God's word comes in and upends everything. When God's word comes in, he can take fools, uneducated rubes, and make them wise. Some of the books of the New Testament written by guys like Peter, and people contest the authorship of the New Testament, of certain books of the New Testament, because they say, there's no way those guys could have written that. Those guys are illiterate fishermen. Well, maybe God help them to use amanuensis to write those things. Or you get really smart guys like Paul, who then spends his life for the foolishness of the gospel. God's word is good for us. But God didn't just leave us with those two things. When I grew up here, we had a great Awanas program, and one of the things that I remembered while I was getting ready for this sermon is Bible quizzes. Alright? Now, this was how nerdy it was, kids. For those of you guys who didn't experience this, we would memorize Bible verses in Awanas, and then we would go and compete against kids from other churches to see who was fastest and best in knowing all their Bible verses. And so it would go kind of like a quiz show game, right? You have somebody up there, a moderator like Dr. Tim, would say, all right, so guys here, where do you find this Bible verse? We'd buzz, or we'd throw a paddle and say, oh, I know that one. It was pretty nerdy, but it was good. It helped us learn God's words. But that wasn't the end goal. That's took me till I kind of started to grow up a little bit and realize how much God was using that sort of thing to shape me into a godly man. The end goal of all these things is so that God's word gets into our hearts and starts to work from the inside out. So that when we look around in the world around us and we realize, wow, those birds are singing the glory of God and I'm not. I wonder if I can learn something from the birds. When I see God's word, it shines into my heart. The third book here, God gives, is our conscience. Our conscience speaks to us of a standard outside ourselves. Another thing that Romans 1 talks about. When we look at the world, when we hear the word, it resonates within us. Now, we can ignore it. We can squash our conscience under. We can dole a volume on it, turn it all down, but it's still there. My encouragement, particularly to you younger ones, you kiddos, when you think something's wrong to do, when you feel like there's something that's telling you, that's wrong. I might not be able to articulate it, but I think that's wrong. It's not a lot of times you can say, my mommy told me it was wrong. And you just go with that. Don't ignore that conscience. It's the way that God speaks to us. What's the purpose of all of that? The world around us. Why look at the world around us? We have plenty of people make a living looking at the world around us and trying to make proclamations about it that ignore the Creator, and they just become fools. So it's not just looking at the world. It's not just reading the world. We want to read the world rightly. We want to open the book the way God tells us to. We want to open the scriptures not just so that we can have knowledge stuffed into our heads, but so that we can hear God's word rightly, so that we can be mature. The conscience is given by God to us so that we can grow up, so that we can be matured into godly manhood. These books are unified. Nature. Did you notice when we read through the book of nature here in Psalm 19, it spent a whole lot of time talking about one thing, right? One thing. It was the sun. Why spend so much of your time in the book of nature talking about one thing, the sun? Well, because without the sun, you're not going to be able to look at the rest of it. Without the sun, we're dead. Without the sun, you can't see anything. Scriptures, without looking at things through a cross-shaped lens, without looking at things through Jesus Christ, we're going to miss the entire point of law. A lot of men around Jesus' day did exactly that, right? We're going to look briefly now and cruise through the law. This is a familiar passage. My parents, I remember, made me memorize this. We would recite it every Sunday night. So it throws me off when I read it in a non-King James Version. But we'll just look at a few brief points here. First off, parents and kids. How does God start out the commandments? Does God simply just, I don't want to drop this, this is my nice study Bible. I usually have a good Gideon's Bible. Did God just drop this book down from the heavens and say, all right, here you go, guys. This is what you do, and this is what you don't do. Is that how he did it? God's word came over and over successively throughout generations. This book is the product of like 1,500 years of God speaking, of God being gracious. But how does these commandments start? It doesn't just start out with Old King James language here, right? Thou shalt and thou shalt not. No, it starts out with God saying, I am the Lord, I am Yahweh, your God, who brought you, Israelites, out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. And then he jumps into the, this is what you should do, and this is what you shouldn't do. So, what do we learn from this? You see this pattern all throughout Scripture. God never simply, if you want a book that just tells you what to do and what not to do, you go get a Quran or something like that. Okay, they're good, and you know, do this and don't do this. They get all mixed up and all wacky, but they're good at the do's and the do nots. The Bible's got plenty of do's and do nots, but it never starts there. God's word starts with him acting on our behalf. He creates He redeems, He rescues, and then He says, all right, guys, now that I've brought you out of the wreck that you made of your lives, here's how you want to live in the world that I made. Here's how you want to live so that you don't fall back into that sort of disaster. Did you know this? We love the Exodus story, right? We love Moses leaving Egypt. The reason they were enslaved, it didn't just happen overnight. The reason they were enslaved is because they went after the gods of the nations. They went after the Egyptian gods. And God said, okay, guys, you want to try being a follower of Egyptian gods? See what it's actually like. And then they became slaves. Right? So first point, God always speaks, acts, rescues. And then He says, here's how you ought to live as a redeemed, rescued, created people. The second thing I want us to look at is, when you hear the Ten Commandments, the ten words, you hear God, he is concerned first with how do we rightly relate to and worship Him. And then the second half is concerned with how do we rightly love and relate to people around us. Because those go together. Those go together. If we love God, we're going to love one another. We're going to love the brothers. If we don't love one another, we're not going to be loving God very well. 1 John tells us lots about this relationship. The love of God, the right love, the right worship of God goes hand in hand with right love of one another. So, kiddos, do you want to be better at loving other people? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, just like Jesus tells us to. Love one another. If you want to be better at loving God, then practice loving your siblings and your mom. If you want to be a better lover of God, then pick up your room. Don't pull your sister's hair. Okay? So those are just a few brief observations. God always speaks and acts, and parents, for us, right? How does God give His law? Does He simply throw down the list of rules from heaven? No, first He acts and He reminds them of His gracious act. Okay? He reminds them of His graciousness. We ought to mimic God in that. We ought to mimic God in being in demonstrating graciousness and love first, and also, you know, not in a self-righteous way, but in a way that points to God and how we say, hey, look, mommy's trying to do these things, daddy's trying to do these things, we're trying to agree with God on these things, therefore, this is how our household is going to be, this is how our household is going to live. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. Let's look at John. As we cruise through the book of John, This was my favorite discovery as I went through this and was learning or studying for this, excuse me. This is an interesting passage. If you read through the Gospels, particularly kiddos, if you ever read through the Gospels, if you read through Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you might start thinking, didn't I already read this? This kind of seems like the same thing. Anybody ever read any kids ever read through the Gospels? All right, I encourage you to do it, because when you read through the Gospels, you might start getting confused. Why did they write three different books? They all seem like they're saying the same thing. Well, they're not, and we can go into how they're not. But when you get to John, it's like, oh my goodness, he's talking different, and he's telling different stories about Jesus. And so some people get all confused about the book of John, and they think, well, maybe John just didn't care about time, because what we see here in John chapter 2 is Jesus coming into the temple and He starts clearing it out and saying that people are turning His Father's house into an emporium, a marketplace. But then if you read the other Gospels, you see, man, something awful similar happened at the end of the other Gospels, right before Jesus died, right before He started saying funny things like, hey, disciples, you see this great, beautiful temple, this eighth wonder of the world? Not one of those stones is going to be left on another. Is this just the same thing? And John just decided to tell us the story at the beginning? plenty of folks would agree with me, but there's good scriptural reason to think, no, there's more than one time that Jesus is doing this. When you look at the Old Testament, is there any kids who can tell me what leprosy is? Anybody ever heard of leprosy? What's leprosy, man? Bunch of like weird stuff on your skin, right? Bunch of weird stuff on your skin. Now, people get all sorts of interesting theories about that. Some folks think that we can tie it to certain diseases today. I don't know about that, but there, if you read through the Old Testament law, you might find leprosy, there was more to do with than just your skin. You can have the same sort of thing, the same sort of idea. You could have clothes that were infected. You could even have houses that were infected. You say, well, that's kind of hard to fit with the disease that I know of today. Maybe they were just putting a group of things, maybe like mildew or something. But the law deals with all these things together. And in the law on how do you deal with house leprosy or a house that is infected with some sort of unclean thing, well, it's kind of funny. If you get sick today, where do you go? Doctors, right? And man, oh man, I was glad to grow up in a church with Dr. Tidwell. It was good for us. But if you got sick with leprosy, or you realize, my shirt, there's something funky here, or hey, there's something weird going on in my house, you wouldn't go to a doctor. You'd go to the priest. And you say, hey, Mr. Priest guy, can you look right there? It looks like something funny is on my head. Can you tell me if this is leprosy or not, or the clothes or the house? And if it was a house, of course, you couldn't move the house to him. He'd have to go and he'd have to look at the house. And the way that it would go is that he'd go and he'd look at the house, and if it looked like it might be leprosy, they'd shut the house up. He'd shut the house up. And then they'd come back after a week and they'd look at it and they'd say, you're good, there's nothing to worry about. Or they would say, uh-oh, guys, your house is infected. What we gotta do? We gotta clean it all out. We gotta clean it all out. And then you can come back and live in it. And then, if this came back after you did the cleaning out, you know what they would do? They'd come and they'd inspect it again and say, guys, we gotta tear it all down. We gotta rip this sucker all down. You see a hint of this in the book of Ezekiel. Read the book of Ezekiel, because man, that's some funky stuff right there. In the book of Ezekiel, in chapter 8, Ezekiel gets transported in this vision. Okay, he is transported by God in a vision, hundreds of miles back to Jerusalem. And then he gets to come and look at the wall. I mean, he gets to come and look at the temple. And when he comes and he looks at the temple, all of a sudden he sees there's a hole in the wall. And he hears a voice. I don't remember reading it, whether it's a voice of an angel or a voice of God, but this voice says, hey, go and dig in the wall. So he goes and he digs in the wall. You know what he sees when he looks through that wall? He sees a bunch of people who are, this is the temple of God, right? Who do you think you're supposed to worship in God's temple? There you go. You're supposed to worship the true God, right? But they were not worshiping the true God. He looks through this little hole in the temple wall, and he sees all sorts of pagan, idolatrous rites going on. You know what happened to that temple? It got destroyed. It got destroyed. So Jesus comes, and he comes into the temple, and he looks around. And he sees things are not going the way that they're supposed to. They brought their coffee bar inside. They were supposed to be, it wasn't the fact that they were selling things, okay? This wasn't the fact that they were selling animals. This wasn't the fact that they were changing money at the tables that Jesus got so angry at. He was angry because of the wear of the wind. Because they took those things from outside the temple where they would have been perfectly fine, and they brought them into the Gentiles' house. They didn't love God like he said to. They didn't obey, they didn't worship God like he said to. And you know, remember, we just read the Ten Commandments. If you don't love God right, are you going to be able to love people right? When they didn't love God right, when they didn't worship God rightly, it ended up being a lack of love for people. Because you know where they put all that stuff? They put all that stuff in the Gentile court. That was where people like you and me, people who are not of direct Jewish descent, that's where they would get to go. If they wanted to come worship God, if they wanted to travel and worship God, that was where they were supposed to go. But they couldn't because these people were not loving God right and weren't loving their brother right. So what is Jesus doing? He's coming. He's inspecting the temple. And he's getting ready to clean it out. And then at the end of his ministry, he's going to come back and he's going to inspect the temple. And then he's going to clean it out again. And right after that, he's going to tell his disciples, hey guys, that temple is going to be destroyed. It's going to be destroyed. But another cool little note here. When Jesus does this in the book of John, and people get kind of upset with him. They say, Jesus, why are you doing this? What's your authority? Where's your badge that says you can do this, Jesus? Well, he could have said, if you'll turn with me to Leviticus, you can see where I'm beginning the process of cleansing the temple. No, that's not what he said, is it? He said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I'll raise it up again. They said, man, this temple was, it took 46 years to build this thing. And you think you can build it up in 3 days? I don't think so. What's Jesus doing? He said, nope, don't you understand? This temple that we're standing in here, it's just a picture. It's a picture of me. It's a picture of God's relationship with humanity. It's a picture of God's place. He said, destroy me. Destroy this temple in 3 days. I'll raise it up. Jesus talks this way in the book of John a lot. Okay, so it's not unique to the Bible there. He says funny things like, I'm the living water. I'm the bread of life. He says really weird stuff like that. His point is to get us to see, this is, when you eat, when you drink, these are things that you just have to have for life, right? You have to have these things for life. But those things are speaking of and reflecting God's nature and character in some way. This is one of the reasons God got so angry at the Israelites when they were, he said, don't you dare make a picture of anything, make an image of anything and say, that's our God. Because if we did that, we get such a small picture of God. We get way too small of a picture of God. We get a God that we can handle, a God that we can control. But no, Jesus is like all these things. Last point in the book of John. Oh, wow. Yep. Last point of the book of John. Then we're going to cruise through 1 Corinthians because I know there's something I want to eat. Jesus, it says here in the book of John, people believed in him. A bunch of people believed in him. Now you think Jesus would be excited and say, all right, kingdom's coming early. But it says Jesus didn't believe in them. Jesus didn't trust in them. Wait a second. I thought we were supposed to trust in Jesus. What's this Jesus doesn't trust in them stuff all about? It says Jesus knew their hearts because he knew the hearts of all men. That's weird. But who else? Who else do we hear described like that? When we turn to 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 39, as Solomon is speaking about God and to God at the dedication of the first temple, he says, God, you alone know the hearts of all men. Now, kids, if you grow up, you're going to have your faith challenged. You're going to have the word of God challenged. And one of the favorite challenges is Jesus never said he was God. There's no Bible verse. You can go where you can hear Jesus say, I am God. You can hear him say, I am. You can hear him say, I am the bread of life. I am living water. You can hear him say that he knows the heart of man. But it's true, you'll never hear a verse that says, I am God. You'll hear it say, I and the Father are one. If you see me, you Father. But you're right. There's never a verse where Jesus says, I am God. But it's all through the scriptures. This is just one voice. The way that John presents it, he says, hey, guess what? Jesus knows all of our hearts. Huh. Who else knows all of our hearts? Oh, that's right. Only God does. Jesus just claims to be able to forgive sins. Who can forgive sins? Only God can. That's the way that the Bible speaks of Jesus over and over. It wants us to read. It wants us to compare Scripture to Scripture so that we can understand. Yes, he really is. Yes, he really is our only hope. And finally, we already read 1 Corinthians, so I won't read it again. Just wanted to make a couple points here. One of the common themes in this whole section, all these readings, is unity. God's world is united in message with God's word, which is united with when we're reading the world and we're reading God's word, right? It's united with our conscience and speaking of our need for God and his holiness. When we read in Exodus 20, we see that God's word, God's law, is unified in itself. The love of God is united with the need for the love of man. They go together. You can't split them up. You can't say, I just want to love God really well, but I don't really care about loving people. Right? They go together. When we read John 2, we see Jesus is united with his Father in what he does. He came to fulfill God's law. When his disciples later on, they remember what Jesus said. He said, wait, I believe the word of God. I believe all the things that we've read so far that I grew up hearing. And I also believe what Jesus says. They go together. And finally, here in Corinthians, we see two different kinds of unity. We see the unity of the world. Where's the only point where the world is united? The only point, you only see the unity of the world in places like Babel and at the cross, where the world says, we don't want to do things God's way. We can't get along with one another. We hate one another, but we're united in this. Anything but God and his law. Kings of the earth, Psalm 2 tells us, the kings of the earth spoke together saying, let's get rid of this God, the Lord, and again of his Messiah. Let's get rid of his law. That's the sort of unity that the world offers. They say, can't we all just get along, but really they don't mean it. Unity that God offers is unity that's bound by the blood of Jesus Christ, that unites people from all different tribes, tongues, races, from all sorts of different classes. We're rich and poor get to meet, where smart guys and dumb guys get to come together and rejoice in the God who has made them all uniquely for purpose. The wise, the simple can come and unite. Christ has bought that unity for us. Let's not settle for the world's false unity. This plea is mostly for you kids. Don't let the rise of the world take your faith. Don't think that if I want to look at the world and understand the way that the world works, then I've got to throw away God's word. Don't think that if I want to be a whole person, if I want to be able to walk through life not crippled by guilt and shame, that I just need to chunk out God's word. The only way, in fact, for us to be the sort of people we're made to be is for us to open the book of God's world, open the book of God's law, and open the book of our hearts, our conscience, which agrees with God's word, and say, God is good, and I'm not, and that's why he sent his son Jesus Christ to die on my behalf, to unite me with all sorts of different people, maybe people that are easy to love, maybe people that aren't. Hope that you guys are blessed. I certainly blessed in preparing this. Hopefully you are half as blessed. God bless all of you.
If I could have the ushers come forward at this time.
those that are going to help with the Lord's Supper. Well, we invite you to join us if you are a believer in Christ, if you're part of His church through faith in Him. I'm going to read from a little different area this morning as we look to the Lord's Supper in remembrance. Many times we'll look at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, but this is actually recorded in one way or another, not fully in John, but in John 13, 2, it mentions they were at the supper and Judas was going to betray Christ. But in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it is fully recorded. I want to read from Matthew this morning. We read in Matthew chapter 26. Now on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying to him, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" "My time is at hand. I will keep the Passover." What Jesus is doing is what Jesus did all the time. Testament. Josiah was mentioning how he did it in the Sermon on the Mount, actually. You have heard it said, Brian was saying that earlier. You have heard it said, but I say, Jesus transformed all kinds of things. And here he is transforming the Passover meal into the Lord's Supper. They were celebrating the Passover together. Now, it's interesting that if you look there, they have to have a lamb at the Passover. This was looking back to what happened in Exodus when God delivered the children of Israel from Egypt. And they had to sprinkle the blood of the Passover lamb on the houses. And he says over in Luke, he says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed." So a lamb had to be killed and a lamb's blood had to be shed. So during this, when they're celebrating the Passover, we read then in Matthew chapter 26, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." So Jesus is standing before them there. They're eating this unleavened bread of the Passover, and he's saying, "Take and eat this bread, which is my body." Now, there's no way that the disciples could have thought this is literally his body. He was standing in front of them. What he was saying is, "This represents my body. I want you to do this in remembrance of me." He's going to say shortly thereafter, in verse 28, "For this is my blood of the new covenant." He was standing before them. His blood was coursing through his veins. It was not literally his blood. Again, he's saying, "This represents my blood." Or this represents. It is not my blood. It was actually the Passover wine, the third cup of blessing, which he transformed into the Lord's Supper.